Are you ready out there in the crowd?
Fought hard and triumphed over many. Now only two teams remain, and the Aegis of Champions hangs in the balance. The International Grand Finals begin!
Here we go then, ladies and gentlemen, the grand final of the International 2015 Evil Geniuses versus CDEC. Gentlemen, it's time for the grand final. Best of five, of course, we should mention that. It's a change from the best of threes that we've been used to. How much does that change the actual dynamics of the drafts, do you think?
We think that favors EG. I think we mentioned that EG, not only are they the most versatile, they also adapt the best intra-series. And best of one, not so much for them. Best of three, best of five, definitely EG has the upper hand.
Okay. CDEC obviously lack a little bit of experience in terms of tournament play. They've had a number of second and third place. They've never won a tournament, let alone the international. How much does that weigh on their mind, do you think?
I definitely think that they're not even thinking about that anymore. But as Ben said, Best of five favors EG. However, CDEC have been so dominant in their performance, I think we're in for a really good series.
Yeah, and we said in the upper bracket game as well that their styles almost benefit each other in a strange kind of way. The comfort zones for CDEC are not worries for EG, and likewise, EG's comfort zones are not a worry for them either. So presumably, they're both happy.
Yeah, I think both are happy, and should be mentioned, in a best of five, you can pull out more strategies than you can in a best of three.
I'd say that EG's comfort zone is actually a problem for CDEC, because for two main reasons. In the series before, we saw that EG, they want Leshrac, Naga, or Teki. So
yeah.
Yesterday, or maybe it was yesterday, maybe we had even telling us that CDEC, they don't want to deal with Leshrac. They always ban Leshrac, they never pick it. So that's a worry for them. Techies is obviously a big worry for them, because when you pick Techies, you're like, you're not going to get to fight us. It's going to be, we've seen it, they're respecting the Techies a lot. And I'm going to give a stat that's very important to me. They did lose to Naga, they didn't want, sorry, versus Naga yesterday, but that was the first time. The only games they lost at TI so far were versus Vega, they had Naga, versus Virtus Pro twice, they had Naga, and versus eHome, and they had Naga. And I feel it makes sense because, you know, they're very aggressive, they catch you off guard, they surprise you, but with Naga you can never get surprised. You just sleep, counter initiate.
But the trouble is, of course, if they ban Naga and they probably ban Techies, they're gonna have to give Leshrac.
Exactly. I think draft wise PPD has a huge advantage.
Yeah. I mean, they won against them in the upper bracket, but lost in the group stages twice against the Techies. So where do they go, Malini? Very quickly.
That's why I was suspecting whether or not they have a strat prepared for the Techies, because I see them in the same conundrum. And this is only if they're second pick. If they first pick, yeah, they can kind of interchange.
Yeah,
definitely.
Wagga, final thoughts?
I just want to see Q against PPD in the draft war right now. I can't really say anything else.
Okay, count them down, people. The grand final is just around the corner.
CDEC Gaming versus Evil Geniuses. Grand Finals, Game 1.
Here we go then. Hold on to your seats. It's going to be a bumpy ride for both sets of fans as Evil Geniuses go up against CDEC in the Grand Final. And we've already seen Leshrac picked in the draft.
This is playing out exactly as Mad predicted here as well. Naga being removed, Teki being removed. I think those are 2 years they want to remove the most, and then of course they did have first pick on CDEC.
What a fast draft. So we have
the speed of this draft is extraordinary.
Those two captains were ready, and I mean, the Naga ban makes a lot of sense, because even though CDEC did win versus Naga yesterday, it caused them a lot of troubles. And sure, they played it really well with the snowball, the visage bird, but that was a, I'd say, a lucky fight in the sense that Naga was actually dominating the game at that stage. And also, you could see the counter initiation yesterday was a big issue for them.
I mean, this only happened because CDEC first pick, so they are able to actually ban Naga,
exactly,
ban Techies and pick Leshrac.
And it felt like, oh, this is the best of five. So PPD was like, he wasn't sure if they would pick Leshrac or not. Maybe he was, at least, but they haven't played Leshrac so much before. So it was a fine gamble for him to actually try to give them Leshrac and see what happens. And he probably did not ban Leshrac, he banned Dax here just to see how would they react for that.
And they responded with the clockwork as well. We talk about it. It could be very deadly against the Leshrac if you have an early blade mail and Lesh. You don't want to be forced into getting an early BKB.
Yeah, definitely. And I'm looking towards Storm and thinking, are CDEC going to ban it out now, or are they going to let EG have it? Because Storm and clockwork combination we've seen over and over again. And with Gyrocopter as your hard carry, you have a nice mix of magical and physical damage.
Yeah, I think it was a really good gamble giving them Leshrac. Some people might think it's dumb, but it's like, you know, if they pick Gyro and you get Lesh clock, that's a huge draft win, and you have advantage whether or not your first or second pick as EG.
Exactly. So you kind of forced them into the Leshrac, and, you know, many other teams have not played it in a long time as well because of how much it's been banned. Sure, it's a strong hero, but it's not a combination straight off.
You guys talk about the Storm, but I actually prefer what CDEC did here. They actually took out the Ember instead of the Storm. We talk about the PL. Ember is much better at dealing with PL compared to having just a Gyro alone.
I mean, EG was definitely ready for that Leshrac pick by the looks of it. I mean, Gyro is a good hero versus Leshrac in the sense that you get a BKB quite early on Gyro, and then Leshrac is not relevant, at least early on in the game.
If you're EG, though, you're wondering why they didn't ban out Anti-Mage.
Indeed. Indeed, because Anti-Mage looks like, I mean, there's the, obviously, we've seen that before, so I'm going to say the Gyro might be carry, that's probably why. But we've seen IG do it, right? They just pick Gyro into Anti-Mage, and then it was a Gyro mid suddenly. I don't know if Sumail, the thing is, I don't feel like Sumail adapts how Ferrari could adapt. I honestly wouldn't like to see this male on the Gyro mid, for example.
I honestly think the Gyro mid was terrible, though. It didn't work out well for them. It just kind of sat there. He didn't have a massive impact that game at all.
No, for sure, but anti-mage is really the pick you need to win the game, and then you just itemize on Gyro like we've seen, just what you need, E-Blade or whatever.
I think they can't approach like that in this game. Shiki and Zumail are way too high-impact players, and Leshrac here is super important to just keep stalling time, buy time for Phantom Lancer, and that's pretty much his job here.
So. But that's not how CDEC plays, though. They just pressure a lot with Leshrac and Phantom Lancer. It's very rarely four make space for one.
Oh, no. The time comes from the active fighting. You need to have strong fighters so that you can go into it.
It's true that the way CDEC plays, giving them Leshrac, when you think about it, it's actually very scary because it's one of the best heroes to do that. You never rely on a cooldown. You can always, you know, push out lanes, take objectives after you actually went for kills with Leshrac with the Edict. It's a bit scary for EG to give them Leshrac. They probably have a plan, but I feel like this is the first game of the best of five, and with the side first pick advantage, it's definitely on CDEC. EG took Dire, but I feel like first pick is going to be key in those finals.
Crystal made him pretty good hero versus Phantom Lancer. I would actually say one of the best supports with her ultimate, and Phantom Lancer no way interrupted it, but at the same time, you're versus Leshrac. You're lucky if you don't die in a couple of seconds.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, anyway, when you look at Leshrac, Phantom Lancer, like, I don't think any hero, you know, fits or is good versus both of them because they're very, like, they have a lot of magical damage with Leshrac, a lot of physical with Phantom Lancer, so you're always going to have heroes that will struggle.
Still, it's pretty good. It's like what we saw versus VG when they had this, or sorry, versus MVP when VG wanted to deal with the Sark, the Clockwork CM combo.
So Mage Storm, we haven't seen it yet. And in the main event, on the main stage, this is the first time we've seen it.
Yeah, EG have banned it plenty of times against other teams, but this time they do get to pick it up themselves. I like the picks from EG so far against the Phantom Lancer, because that's an early reveal of Phantom Lancer. Going into a hero that can gank really well in Storm Spirit, a hero that has good AoE damage, which is ever so crucial in Crystal Maiden. If you can Glimmer Cape her and just get the ulti off, that could be huge.
I mean, look at CDEC's lineup as well. They don't really have very good lockdown. Leshrac's stun is not reliable. There's only Winter's Curse right now, and Storm is going to be a hero that thrives in those type of environments where the opponent can't lock you down.
The only thing, though, is that Leshrac is very strong versus Storm mid. I feel like it's a very good matchup for the Leshrac because it's really hard for Storm to just go in and drop Remnant to get in order to get some creeps. You can easily get killed by the Leshrac.
I mean, to counteract that, they have the CM, and she's going to be... I assume PPD will take up that hero, and he is going to be in charge of actually trying to get an early gank to actually help and upset the balance of the Storm versus Leshrac lane.
That could do a lot, because if the Storm does get ahead, then he can just solo kill the Leshrac over and over again.
Yeah, ganks towards Storm's lane could be really useful, but I also think that it's important to get a good game on Clockwork in this game. If he gets a Blade Mail early, he can do wonders against the Lesh. So I wonder if they want to focus a lot on ganking for the Storm, or if they're going to try and win the other lanes and leave Zumail to his own device, because he has made some insane comebacks before.
I think we're assuming it's a Leshrac mid, okay, which now it probably is, but still, we could be looking at something else than Leshrac mid, and we don't really know how CDEC plays at Leshrac.
True.
They haven't shown it really yet.
I mean, at the same time, the only time that we've seen Leshrac really move to support is when they've drafted multiple counters, Anti-Mage and Pugna, I think in particular, sometimes the Nyx Assassin. Mm-hmm. But I think there's no reason why they shouldn't run a mid.
I would definitely agree. Yeah. There is no natural counter in Leshrac in this game. We said the Clockwork could be one if he gets an early Blade Mage, but besides that, it's...
I like how we saw Aoi there, and his top heroes is Teki now as well, available there with 3-0, one of his best performances.
I mean, with the Spirit Breaker there, I think Leshrac is more or less likely to be just the mid hero here.
Oh yeah, more than definitely. So, CDC, what are you looking to remove now from EG?
I think the Undying... Oh, from EG. The Undying ban from EG was quite smart. As we said, Spirit Breaker Undying, very classic CDC duo on the offlane. Remove from EG, they're probably looking for the AoI hero, AoI. We're not sure which one he wants to play yet. Can they play Enigma? Is Enigma an option for them?
Smart choice on the Visage, actually. That could have been a very good fighting hero. Visage is one of the best skirmish heroes in the game, so removing him is quite wise, especially with the Crystal Maiden mana aura as well.
I honestly think Enigma could be an option for EG. An early mech to fight versus CDEC, because EG, they have a lot of fighting heroes right now. I mean, all those heroes can fight very early on and respond to aggression.
It sort of works, but there's two different skills that can cancel your BKB ulti even, so that's the only reason I feel it's kind of tough. But Enigma can do a lot of work besides his Black Hole.
Yeah, exactly. It's more about the mech and the early fighting. Black Hole will be reliable, later on in the game, but they can't really count on it. I'm just thinking, because we haven't seen CDC really go offensive. aggressive way. He needs a good start in order to play how he plays. He needs to be able to farm his drums or whatever. He needs to be active. If he gets underleveled, underfarmed early on, he's probably not going to be a factor.
Skywrath Mage.
Oh, really? A Skywrath last pick? I worry for a Skywrath against a Spirit Breaker and PL running him down, but this is very curious. Good with Clockwork. You have the hook, the cog, and then Skywrath ulti combo.
Good versus the Cold Embrace.
Yeah. Very aggressive
draft. You can't move, and you just take the full ball from Mystic Flare.
Very aggressive draft from EG.
It's only part of two wins of 8 picks so far at TI5 as well. Not the most successful.
Yeah, but it does hard counter the Winter Wyvern, that is true. He cannot save anyone really with that with the Cold Embrace.
It doesn't scale that well though. I've seen it in theory. It's like, okay, well, yeah, you can just Mystic Flare him, but the Cold Embrace just heals you percentage based. So like 20, 30 minutes, or when you get BKBs, he's useless. Skywrath is.
Also, the reality might be that Skywrath just gets face rushed by Spirit Breaker and PL. Like, we have seen how CDEC play. So they have to do really good counter initiations.
Yeah, Universe is going to have a tough job with that Clockwork in order to make sure his supports can position themselves and survive the first initiation from CDEC.
His role is super important in this game, yes.
So we're looking at what, last support, maybe what, Rubick Disruptor, something?
Most
Witch Doctor.
Yeah, I think any support will...
Wow, there we go.
All right,
wow.
That's not a support, so it's probably a Spirit Breaker support and an offering, Queen of Pain.
Okay, thank you very much, gentlemen. We'll be back after the match for their analysis on game one. But for now, it's down to the main arena with your commentary team for the grand finals, Syndarin and Toby One.
Let's get it underway, the International 5 Grand Final. It will be Evil Geniuses going up against CDEC Gaming. I'm Toby One, joined by Syndarin. We'll be holding your hand through the next couple of hours when we will find out who will take Immortality, the biggest title in Dota 2 calendars, is right here, is the International.
Yeah, and what a game to get us started on. I am so excited for these drafts. I mean, there's so many things to talk about for this game that are new in the tournament that we haven't seen up until the grand final. We've got, for the first time, we have CDEC actually playing Lishrak, I do believe. I don't think they've played it ever before. And would you believe it, they're actually once again trying to trick EG, similar to yesterday in the winner bracket final when they picked a Bounty Hunter early in the draft and switched it to the offlane. It's a support Lesh being played by Garter. And the moment you saw the Queen of Pain pick, you were like, okay, this has to be a support Spirit Breaker together with the AA. But guess what? It's actually not. It's an offlane Spirit Breaker for XC. They probably feel like core Lishrak here might be countered a little bit too hard by EG's picks. I'm not sure if it was, but you know, they just they changed their plan up. For EG, we have a Skywrath Mage as well. One of their pocket picks, I would say. Pretty much no other team in this tournament really plays Skywrath anymore, but as the panelists pointed out, good synergy with Clock, good against the Winter Wyvern's Cold Embrace, but of course, a very glass cannony support you can easily get turned on by CDEC's heroes, so what a game this is going to be.
Yeah, man, I was actually worried when I first saw the Skywrath Mage coming up, as in wonderful style, we will have a moment to contemplate our thoughts, but to pick up something like a Skywrath Mage, and then you can have a Spirit Breaker charging around. Skywrath Mage isn't really the greatest. The panel we're talking about, like maybe, like they're actually talking about like CDEC's pickups, but normally looking for things like Rubick or anyone that can really mess around with a Spirit Breaker charge in or when the jump comes. What is the purpose of this Skywrath Mage? Is he here to stop the Lishrak? Is that the purpose of EG right now?
It's just a good solution to multiple problems they will have. I think they wanted it for the silence, first of all, and to counter out the Cold Embrace of the Wyvern. And in addition to that, of course, as mentioned, the synergy with Clock is great, but also the synergy with Stone Spirit, I think, is very nice here for AOI 2000. But it's interesting. It's something else coming out here from EG. As we do have a little bit of a problem, I think it's getting fixed right now.
It looks like it's actually over in CDEC's booth at the moment, but yes, fix our problems nice and quickly. Obviously, there's so much on the line with the TI5 Grand Final, and while the prize money is the biggest we have ever had in the history of Dota 2, we are looking at more than that. It is the ability to claim the prize. CDEC, this is a team which started in the qualifiers. They came through. I'm glad you rise to the occasion, Fidrin.
I already sat down. I was ready. You just kept standing.
I'm too hyped. Okay. I got to stand.
I will stand up a bit.
But right now, like, okay, so CDEC, you've come through the qualifier. You weren't even first in the qualifier. eHome came through in the number one position, so you had to play the wild card when you finally got to Seattle. The uncertainty of knowing if you're even going to play in the main event, and then you get to the main event, you feel the rest, you feel the relief, and then you just get yourself into your zone, and they performed so well. Now we can actually get back into the game because we're back underway. But CDEC, aggressive.
Okay, he is...
He's stopping the block.
Yeah.
By coming in here and actually removing that tree, he's making it so the creep wave cannot be held in place by Universe's Cogs, ensuring he gets control of the lane.
This is the only real counterplay that exists, unless you want to gank Clockwork behind his tier 2 tower at minute 0. Not advisable. Don't try it at home. And you just have to run in and remove this tree in this case. Of course, if Universe, he would have seen it, because he saw the Phantom Lancer taking damage from the tower, and as a result, he'll probably just be cogging his creeps as best as possible closer to his tier 2 tower while they're still slow. It's pretty easy to get at least 3 of them into the cog, and he should still have an okay start. It's not...
Yeah, especially if he does that.
That's extra good.
You try and stop Universe, then Universe just stops the wave. But at least Aggressive is going to be able to still find his good farm. The creep waves have been well blocked up by Universe. If he blocks this up anymore, he's going to be farming up underneath his own tier 1 tower. And the Wyvern's going to be here too to slow the creep wave down. He's passing in range of his tier 1 tower. Safest clockwork ever. But we have to keep our eyes on the other lanes as well. So we have to look over towards the middle lane. Obviously, Samael versus Shiki. We want to see how this lane goes. There's actually top lane, Owie, in real trouble. The Rock of Barrage from Fear. And a pushback XZ. But yeah, that middle lane, Samael versus Shiki. Samael's got the upper hand multiple times when they're faced up.
A little bit of a double X. Okay. Not sure what. Let's go. Okay.
No Kale.
All right, we're ready to go again. So yeah, this is a matchup I actually want to talk quite a bit about, because the Samael versus Shiki matchup was the one that favored EG the most in the winner's bracket final that they still ended up getting 2-0'd in, but Samael played a Radiant Shadow Fiend against Shiki's Dire Templar Assassin in game 1, and he crushed him in lane. Like, you know, Shadow Fiend can do well against TA if you are familiar with the matchup and play it well, but I don't think I've ever seen a Shadow Fiend at this level of play beat a TA out as hard as Samael did in that game. And this game, he's off to a really good start too. This is a matchup that's generally considered favorable for the Queen of Pain. He's 6-1 against 2-0 right now, almost bullying Shiki back to his tower, has to use the salve already.
And it's not even the creep waves which are imbalanced at the moment, it's just Samael getting the more last hits. And you're right, Shiki, he's in a rough position. The bottle has already arrived for Samael, so he's going to have that regeneration to keep the spam going against Shiki. And that might mean you're going to need some rotation, some support. Is this when we look towards the Mango carrying Mad Cow? It is the Spirit Breaker who can come and help out.
And knowing CDEC, they will be looking for some aggression early on, one way or the other. For now, Garter's just going to take the top bounty rune. He might just rotate in to try and zone Samael a little bit, but needs to be careful. He is already, as they know,
Samael needs to get out of here.
He is.
He's slowed down. The stun is not going to connect, but Samael still so low on life. It's going to be first blood going the way of CDEC. That's the start they want. That's the rotation they want, and that's the balance required for CDEC to get up the upper hand in EG's mid lane.
I feel like Samael could have probably seen that coming and go back. He actually has a top ward at the... He has a ward at the top rune that would have seen the rune being taken at 2 minutes, and that's when he just needs to back out immediately as he sees Garter rotating, so... Might have just been paying a little bit too much attention to his one-on-one matchup and a little bit too little on the minimap, and this is obviously really good for CDEC getting Shiki on the map here.
XZ might be in trouble. Frostbite. He's only going to get harassed out of this top lane. There's concussive shot as well with the orbs to just push him down even further. But you've still got a salve left on the Spirit Breaker as he tries to soak up as much XP from this top as possible. But this is one thing too which we have to keep our eyes on. The difference in farm between aggressive as well as fear. Right now is 12-3 against 18-11. So many denies for aggressive. Universe, while he might be in range of this lane, it's not a wonderland for him to be here. He's not getting a hell of a lot out of the lane. I say that when I look at almost level 4 clockwork on an offlane. He's done a pretty damn good job so far.
Yeah, he's just outmatched when it comes to attack damage. Clockwork actually has pretty good base damage, but PL is one of the absolute highest in the game. He currently sits on 79 damage against Clockwork, 64. So even if they're fighting for the CS, Aggressive will have the upper hand. And as a result, he doesn't have to buy a Quelling Blade. He's not going for that, just working directly into a Magic 1. And we'll probably see his standard build into... Oh, let's see. Yeah, it's just
Doppelganger away. No real threat from that, but it's the middle lane where the threat is. The charge coming on Samael. He's not level 6 yet. The Lothrak's done. Well, in short, Samael stays exactly where he is. The lightning strikes twice on Samael. He really needed that level 6, but CDEC, the rotation timing is perfect. And EG, they don't really have an answer. There's no movement coming out from Aoi and PPD. They're spending all their time inside the EG jungle.
Yeah, I would like to see EG get a little more active. They're doing a pretty good job in the top lane as far as securing Fear his farm. And they probably have a feeling that the overall farm game is going well, so Mail should... If you're this experienced and you play in a mid lane like this, and I'm saying this experienced, Mail is still a young player, right? But he's played a lot of tough matches already. He should have a pretty good feeling that he's out farming his opponent. We'll just know.
We're going again on mid. Third time lucky again for CDEC. They're going to charge into Samael. Still no level 6 under the tower. There's just no support to come in. Shiki was low, but there's not enough damage for a revenge kill. And that's now 0-3 on Samael. But I look back to the clockwork! The Queen of Pain thought he was safe, but Universe with a level 3 rocket flare from the bot lane picks him off on the way back, and EG gets something back.
Notice, by the way, how good a job CDEC are doing with the rotation. So the first gank, I think, could have definitely been avoided by Samael because he had the ward. The second one is with the smoke, and the third one is with the Wyvern coming from the other cliff. So he's like, okay, Lushrak is top now. They're not going for the gank. They just mix it up. They keep the aggression on that middle lane, and they realize when they look over their draft, Storm is going to be the biggest problem. I think that they have good solutions for pretty much everything else. The gyro matches up pretty well against PL, but we've seen in previous series that PL can definitely get the job done. They have the Winter's Curse against him too. Spirit Breaker is great. And even the Lushrak as a support, until Gyro gets BKB, can really cause him a lot of problems, slowing down his mobility.
Man, CDEC are burning so many smokes early on. They're coming again, and PPT, he's a man that has to keep the eyes out. Samael's trying to flash farm back up to the higher levels, and well, they're not going to find him. In fact, they move up looking for the gyro underneath the tier 1 tower. Look for the TP supports. There's not one over on Storm Spirit, but there is one for the Crystal Maiden. Don't know if she can really stop this attack, however. And CDEC, in fact, they've only got another 3 seconds left of this smoke before it's going to wear off. And in fact, the smoke is going to break because Fear's sitting in the tree line. So no joy for it, but they're still going to charge in. And what can Fear really do? He can do a call down. Aoi, the Sonic Wave doesn't kill him. Sealed up over the Queen of Pain, but it's got to be mopped up by Fear. Looking for another one. No blink. 6 seconds of peep, and he will hold him here. EG take 2 kills. And XZ, he's trapped in the tree line. He wants to charge down. Do they have a stun? Hookshot from Universe is up and running, and he latches him in the tree line. The seal is there, and XZ will die in the trees. It's 3-0. The smoke gang took so long from CDEC. They tried to force the issue, and it was shoved back down their throats by EG.
EG just read that perfectly. They backed out at the right time. I'm surprised CDEC actually chose to go for that next to the tier 1 tower with a level 6 gyrocopter. The counterplay from Fury is very easy. And Universe got a fast level 6 because of that rocket kill he got earlier, so he's able to jump up to the top lane and help out as well.
This is the moment where you realize, like, okay, you shut down Samael. It goes back to the older stories. Samael gets killed time and time again. There was even one game, remember, he was 0-7, and then just one fight, and he goes straight back up again. That was when Fear was playing as Juggernaut. They just buy space for the rest of the cause, and it only takes a couple of fights in this game of Dota to turn your advantage around. And right now, even Samael, he's sitting at the third highest net worth on the field for being 0-3 on the board.
He's above just the found Queen space. Of Pain.
Yeah, he's actually out farming the Queen of Pain right now as far as it goes, but there is still the big factor, the aggressive factor. He is level 8 and sitting at the top net worth at 3.5k.
And he is going to get involved. He always does. He's one of the most effectively rotating early game carries. I think in other situations you would have even seen him being a part of that top fight at minute 6, but this time around he decides to stay bottom.
I think he's still waiting for an action rune. Like he picks up the bounty rune and then we'll farm up the jungle. But the action rune belongs to Samael. So he's flash farming up in the jungle. He's got himself a regeneration rune. And this Storm Spirit, actually really viable in the jungle with the high levels up in the Static Remnants as well as the 4 points overload. You can just go through camp so quickly.
Shiki's gonna have to find some farm. Well, oh, it's just gonna die. That's an alternative.
Aoi came in at the right time with the blink. Shiki gets away to safety.
Lots of one charges there.
Surprisingly enough, Aoi actually went for the third point up in the Arcane Bolt. Yep. So he doesn't have the higher level up in Ancient Seal, which is normally what you look for if you're looking for the control, the control factor from the silence.
Yeah, if he would have maxed out Ancient Seal, that would have been a kill. But the question is what implications.
Universe
would
bottom
have had in the
lane. He's trying to go after Winter Wyvern with a hook shot down with a battery assault. Wyvern Arctic Burn will just run himself away. The battery assault, Universe looking for the proper procs. But he can't get it on the Wyvern, and now they can turn this around. Splinter is still available, and Aggressive's coming in too. The lands, Universe just decides to TP out. There's no stun, so there's no kill.
Good play under pressure here from Q. Just playing it nice and slow and getting out of trouble. Forcing Clockwork back to base is going to allow Aggressive to maybe almost take this bottom tier 1 tower, or at least have someone else from EG run down there, if not Universe again, all the way back from base.
This for me just feels so rare. Like after the fight fails for CDEC on the top, they're not pressuring EG to really react to anything. This is now the third time Samael's gone into the jungle just to flash farm up. And even by doing this flash farm, he's brought Aoi up to level 6. So the Mystic Flare is now online as well. More issues for heroes like Spirit Breaker when they charge in, or Queen of Pain to get burst damage down, where they also try and make that leap for a kill. There's a lot of problems which are starting to really rack up here for CDEC.
The one thing they obviously still have going for them is Aggressive. And it's a very natural part of Phantom Lancer's build-up to get Diffusal and or Mantis style, which both are really good against the Skywrath. So I think, as far as the PL is concerned, the only hero he's really worried about in this game is the Gyrocopter. And I do believe that's part of the reason that CDEC really wanted to gank that top lane earlier and try to get some pressure out. Because not only could they have denied the Gyrocopter some farm, but they could have also got Aggressive at bottom tier 1 tower if this fight had been a bit more successful. But as it is right now, EG have stacked up so much farm for Samael. Like, he got two or three jungle camps that were like double or triple stacks. So as a result, now he is actually second on net worth. He's overtaken the PL, who is behind the Gyro of Fear, since he got the better fight in the top lane.
And they're about to get more. Even. Universe is prepped on the hillside. He wants just a hook shot down the Spirit Breaker, allowing Samael to jump himself across the river, and there's your hook shot down, and the Cogs are gonna push him back. Not the perfect initiation. Now they can try and turn around with the Split Earth misses. You do commit the Nether Strike, and Universe trying to get out with the Mystic Flare. The Sonic Wave will at least kill off the Clockwork. And EG needs to back out. Then again, CDEC does. Samael back in. A huge call down from Fear. They're gonna take one, gonna take two, a double for the Gyro. And now they can add pressure towards the tier 1 tower. Actually, maybe not that much. I'll have to back up. Aoi's injured. And the rest of the team want to go back to their timings. CDEC again, and they just commit into fights, which EG have the numbers. They have. They're ready to team fight up against Team CDEC.
Yeah, they were missing the Wyvern. It was hanging in the bot lane, getting now level 7 on Q. Could have been a very big difference maker in that fight. But he stays in the bottom lane. He's most definitely going to be involved the next time. And the thing is, if you look at a fight like that, how it's structured, so they get a good call down from Fear, and then Samael jumps in. Those two heroes will naturally be very close to each other when they go for the same target. That's where the Winter's Curse can really mess up your fight. But obviously it wasn't available there, so EG get themselves a good win in that fight, and it's going to rocket Fear way ahead of the PL now. He's more than 1,000 net worth in the lead now, because he, of course, got two kills, and one of them was on that PL.
And that's such good news for the Gyro. Anything which will push you to get that damage-dealing item after you've got your initial items, your required items for the Gyro, allowing him to deal even with the PL, does get more farm and more strength behind him. Samael coming in for a jump. He's got a regeneration rune going all the way down the Winter Wyvern. Doesn't want to take a hit, still got more of that regen rune. And they do get the pick off the Wyvern. And Shiki's trying to add as much pressure towards the middle lane as possible, force EG to come back. Same with the Spirit Breaker. That Creep Wave will reach the top tower, and who's the man that's going to be TPing in? It's Samael, still with the back of that regeneration rune. It hasn't timed out yet, but he needs more support to TP forward. Either that or he feels he can go it alone. No, he's not alone. Fear waiting on the hillside. Now he's going to come down. Aggressive goes into the doppelganger, but the call down, nice done. But they're in the middle of the call down. No, where's it going to be? They're going to take two again. This time it's over on Aoi. The support is important. And it's now 9-4 in favor of Evil Geniuses. The gold will start to take a dip in favor of EG, with 3,000 going their way. Net worth as well. And this is now three fights in a row where CDEC have come off worse for wear.
Fear with a perfect read there. It was really Like, you could tell exactly what he was thinking the moment he started running in. So they jump on the PL with the Storm, and instead of calling down on him, he walks down into the middle of the fight and casts the cooldown where he's anticipating the doppelganger will go into. And then he hits both the PL and the Lashrak, who was coming in to back up. So he cuts off their escape path, giving them two kills there, where if he would have gone for the direct cooldown on the target, they would have got no one, I think. So really, really crucial play out of Fear. Gets him two assists, and it brings Samael even... Like, he hasn't just come back, he's actually leading now. And the Skywrath of AUI gets two kills, which is also great. It's a very farm-dependent support, I would say, compared to a lot of others. It is very fragile, but can compensate for it with the right amount of gold, of course.
Fierce getting back in front, though. He just felt like they've been prepping this ancient stack for a while, and CDEC are in no position to really contest it as well. So you're going to get a lot of money coming into the Jara. This will complete his Yasha. At this point, is it worthwhile going in for something like... Is it just the standard SMY build with the helm and the Aquila?
I think so. When you're playing from ahead, it's such a good item build for a gyrocopter. And he's definitely going to go BKB somewhere down the line, but I don't think he'll go Yasha into BKB in this case, since he has a really good supporting cast. The Clockwork can, of course, help him out a lot. If he gets focused really hard, it makes so much space for Samael.
Oh, man. PPD. He's reading this perfectly. He threw down a sentry ward exactly the same time as the Radiant Observer ward went down next to the tier 2 tower in the mid lane. I kind of feel like EG have managed to find CDEC's number in this game. They understand where the move is going to come. They try and find the trade-off. And like the one time when CDEC then group up for a big smoke commitment into EG's jungle, there's no stacks, so you can't even steal that. Fear went down for the Radiant, for the Dire Ancients at that point. And the rest of EG moved into the Radiant jungle now.
They still do claim the first tower of the game, and it's an important one. This is the access point tower into the Dire jungle that CDEC loves to play in. So they're probably not going to be able to defend their own either. So as a result, they'll just look to pressure the top tier 2 as much as possible here. They do have ward superiority in the area. It's already been secured quite well inside the Dire jungle. Sure, PPD got the sentry down for the one close to tier 2 mid, but they also have the one above the... or next to, rather, the tier 2 tower top on the cliff.
Let's have a look.
I don't think they're going to try to give it away for free here. They want to fight for it.
Well, if they can take the tier 1 tower first on bop, then go up, then it's all going to be fine. Samael's going to be the man to TP up. Again, this is what now his third or fourth regeneration rune he's managed to find. And he'll look for the opening over on CDEC. There goes your tier 1 tower going the way of Fear. It is going to be the SMY build from him. And there goes that Observer what I was talking about. The PPD will mop up with the help of the Satter. And CDEC are waiting for him. The SB actually is going to charge in Samael. Ball lightning's away. And now it could be PPD with a Frostbite trying to catch him out of position. The Orchid is up for Samael so early. It's going to guarantee a kill on the Spirit Breaker. And they might look for more here. That regeneration rune has been triggered by Samael and Universe. The hook shot in, catching out Garda. The cooldown will be there too. They cannot help the Pony. You'll lose with the Wipe. Three for nothing. EG are rampaging through game number one of the TI5 Grand Final.
They are getting the maximum value out of this region.
Storm.
Yeah. Just for creeps this time.
I actually thought he was going down for the Queen of Pain.
And the region expires. That's efficiency right there. That was questionable charge from the Spirit Breaker. I think XZ, I don't know what he was expecting. He wanted to just force the Storm to jump away, which he managed to, but he should have seen the Orchid and the regen. They have plenty of time when Samael was inside their ward to check him out. And the counterplay from EG just way too quickly with PPD coming down from below.
For a team that's only taken one tier one tower, the amount of money that EG has got is unbelievable. Aoi's almost finished a full mech on a support Skywrath mage.
I think doesn't he have it?
Actually, yeah, you're right, he does. It's all on the courier. Sorry, it's all back in his stash. Boom, there it is, TP's back, completes it up, so we get SNY under 18 minutes. You get a full mech and arcane boots on a Skywrath mage. Even Clockwork has a blade mail, which is causing all sorts of troubles for CDEC. Lashrak at this point will basically kill himself.
Speaking of Lashrak, it's interesting to see he didn't level up his ultimate. It's something we generally see core Lashraks do, because they want to be more in the middle of the fight since they have more farm. But Garter, being a support, really wants to try to keep his distance. And it's a big part of the strength of the hero, really, the Pulse Nova. But in this game, I think he's making the right call, not leveling it. Mm-hmm. And just getting the point edict for in case they win a team fight where he's playing from the back, they can start taking down towers with the edict.
Is this the right call for the Spirit Breaker to go for something like a Hand of Midas? Is this not going to delay CDEC?
I think at this point they have to play for late game. They know they're far behind in this game. It's a pretty unusual situation to see them in. We should remember, though, that the first game of the winner's bracket final between these two teams, EG actually had a really good lead in game one. And then all of a sudden, CDEC got a really good team fight and turned it around, so.
Top lane, Samael gonna go on the Spirit Breaker. Still has an Orchid available in Spirit Breaker. He's gonna pop from the Orchid damage, even with the TP back. Ooh! Just one more attack from Samael would have ensured that. Maybe miscalculation there.
Looked like he let him live.
He did.
Their mercy there. He definitely had time.
Oh,
for
middle lane. Yeah, she got the CM ulti going down. A blink out from Shiki. He'll be able to survive. Universe initiated him with that hook shot. And now they're trying to finally get the tower, but aggressive. Sealed up. Domestic flare burning through the PL. One shot just can't keep him alive. Not with the call down connects. Sonic Wave will not do enough. Smouse back to the fight, but not enough mana. But then again, we went to Wyvern. Locked in control. They finally pick up on him. Moving to the next target. Down to Gata. He is just getting golden rocketed down by EG. While mercy might have been granted on the top lane, it was not in mid.
And I want to point out something we forgot to mention, the stat that we just saw earlier. Samael got the fastest Orchid we've seen in the tournament after dying three times in lane. They just stacked the jungle so much for him, and they maximized his farming output really, really well. And now they get a tower as well. And, you know, that's the problem, right? You could see the game plan for CDEC was, okay, we want to gank the Storm and slow him down so he can't do exactly what he's doing right now. Should have ganked him five times, I guess.
I don't think that would have helped. What they had to do is contest the EG jungle. But it had to be something that was also flagging for CDEC. Like, Skywrath Mage did a little bit of chip damage early on. Maybe you're thinking, oh, the Crystal Maiden's just in the jungle farming up herself. But because they were just so efficient on their stacks, EG, maybe CDEC just didn't see it coming. Right now, they will have to see this coming. The charge coming in from XZ up on top of the hill. He's going for PPD. Able to connect, but Universe has hookshot available. Actually canceling the Nether Strike. Now with a Frost Blast. And the ulti is up. Let it go. Shiki blinks himself in. PPD does not want to be here. In fact, they're hookshotting away to safety. I don't know if PPD will be able to survive this. He's trying to run himself away. The charge is starting up again. It will be the sacrificial Crystal Maiden. But that is the first kill CDEC's got in a while.
Yeah. And notice, by the way, how CDEC are taking the fact that they're behind, right? They're not starting to play defensively and like, oh, this is not going well, we have to just farm up for a bit. They're really just looking for whatever fights they can with their charge and with their vision. A lot of other teams in this situation would just let EG get complete map control and dominate them, but they don't play like that. That's just how it is.
Top lane, the TPs are coming in. That's the clockwork on the front line. Universe turns on the blade mount. Aggressive hurts himself so much, and Samael, well, against the Orchid over on Aggressive, but that's not the target he's really surging for. Keep your eyes over on Q. Watch for that curse, and CDEC could try and turn this one around if they really want it, but fear behind him. Concussive shot will slow down Aggressive. No doppelganger available, but EG, they're getting locked up in the creep wave as well as a couple of PL illusions. They do not find the counter initiation on CDEC, but they do save their tier 2 tower.
It's a little bit questionable buyback there from PPD. I think he bought back so late that he would have never caught up to the fight anyways. Maybe he was expecting Samael to be able to catch there as well as Universe, but neither of them got the initiate they were looking for. Storm missed his ball lightning, and then the fight is kind of over. When you use your entire mana pool and you don't get the jump with Storm, even if Hookshot comes in from Universe, they probably lose the fight, because it's very important for them that Samael is able to deal the damage he can right now.
Speaking of that, Samael might have some issues. Queen of Pain just picked up an Orchid. So the Queen of Pain now finally has a disable against the Storm. But I also wonder then, what is our next item for the Storm? And it's already answered. He's got a Bloodstone Recipe. So that's his next target. Lashrak, that's not a healthy place to be. Universe fighting him in the jungle. At the same time, PL may not let this go unpunished. Universe wants to run away, but it's not going to happen until Storm! Samael's in! He gets the Orchid of the PL! It looks like an instant kill for Universe, and now it's going to be a double kill for Samael! Three down in the jungle, and EG once again, they bring in the cavalry!
Perfect turnaround. Universe is just too tanky. It takes a
Samael's going again. Big jump this time. Orchid on Orchid. They will have that curse there to slow down Samael. Can he jump away? No, he'll pop. That is a huge kill for a Queen of Pain. At the same time, though, Fear is almost taking out this tier 2 tower by himself. Now he's sitting on the sidelines being a spectator, and there goes the tier 2. But the amount of money for the Queen of Pain, 780 gold just for that kill on the Storm Spirit. 571 was also shared with the Wyvern. And he's able to pick up the Glimmer Cape. That's a huge item for CDEC.
Yeah, this is the item against
PPD,
Skywrath Mage.
Run. Pump those little legs and get out of there. He may have enough life. There she, no, he doesn't. He is so totally dead. As XZ will come in. No 17%, doesn't require it. The Queen of Pain Orchid Pop does the work. Universe, however, well, he's got Hookshot available with Veer here. He'll cancel the TP out. You might have killed the Crystal Maiden. But more was taken from me with the Spirit Breaker now on the sideline for 43 seconds.
It's still advancing the game plan of CDEC. Of course, this is not the early game they were looking for. They're 10,000 behind, and EG have done an exceptional job at utilizing their Clockwork and Storm Spirit combination, just finding all these pickoffs to thwart the usual playstyle of CDEC. But with that said, Kiel is getting toward his defusal, and we've seen so many games aggressive, how scary he can get. Generally, we haven't seen him dying four times in the early game, though, so it is definitely a little bit of a different type of game.
It really is.
But EG can't just play slow. Like, if they just rest a little bit, I think CDEC are going to bring the fight to them when they have the defusal.
If you look at the itemization, though, of EG, like, they're preparing themselves for this. You look over towards Aoi now. You've already done your work and picked up a mech for the team, but now he's going to buy a full drums as well for the team. Every item which EG have got, even the bracer, which is over on the Crystal Maiden to go with the urn, it brings up over 1,000 life and allows her to stand during the fights. EG are prepared the CDEC are going to try and fight them. And because the supports are also picking up these items, it's allowing the course to go for other things, like the early Blade Knot from Universe, the work into the Aghanim Scepter, and Fear. Like, he got a full BKB as well, 25 minutes in, to go with his SMY, or the Orchid from Storm. And then the Bloodstone follow-up. And with the death of Roshan, that's the full Bloodstone done, and the Aegis the Immortal to go the way of Smail. I think EG are prepared for CDEC's attack.
Oh yeah, they definitely are. There's no doubt that they're leading this game by a lot, but
it's only 12,000.
Only 12,000.
It's 12,000 net worth as well as experience. It's a decent lead for EG.
That's the furthest CDEC have been behind at the main event, like by quite a bit. I think almost every game we've seen them play, they've been leading. And then they had that one game against EG in the Winner's Bracket Final, game one. I believe they were behind by like 5,000, 6,000, maybe 7,000 in that, and managed to turn it around. This one could just be too much for even CDEC to manage.
It might be, but you never know until it's over. For now, CDEC still keep their minds on the prize, and that is EG's base. If they can take a fight in Arrakis directly after, there's an aggressive observer ward which is actually watching the movement just outside the dire base. And then, as far as the rest of their vision goes, it's really not that terrific. They leave one defensive ward around the Tier 2 tower, but both wards are perfect. So if they are trying to push out the top lane, they'll see EG preparing a defense, and if they are looking to defend their bottom, they'll see where EG are looking to attack from. For now, though, EG, they're preparing more of a presence in the mid lane, and that's where their observer ward is, watching aggressive moving around. And another one also on top lane, but they won't see the Invis Queen of Pain.
The one around the mid lane has 20 seconds left, and I think this could be the reason why EG are just going for it right now. They have the Aegis on Storm, they still have the vision that they can use for a little bit longer, and Fear with the BKB as well, with 10 second duration remaining, could very easily lead the charge. There's a very, very limited number of options for CDEC to take this fight. They're just going to let it go. Well, once again, as always, they will be split pushing a bit with aggressive as much as he can. All this pressure is being put on by EG.
He still needs more money. He's another 700 before this defusal blade is completed, and by that time, he may not have any exterior towers. They need to do something about this sometime soon. For EG, just keep out farming them across the map. It's still a steady gain going the way of Evil Geniuses. Even though aggressive, yes, he's finding more money, the rest of his team is kind of stalling up a little bit more. The Spirit Breaker is finding something, but he had to buy a bracer as well as a cloak just so he can survive for the next engagement. And Queen of Pain, actually a lot of money on Shiki. He's the highest net worth over on CDEC at the moment, just about to crack the 10K mark. And what does he do with his 2.8K? Do you look for aggression? Do you look for defense with BKB? Or what's the goal?
It's a difficult question to answer, because BKB definitely helped. Oh, wait a sec.
Long jump up, found two. Sans is a Spirit Breaker, so we can kill him one. In comes Universe, cancelling the TB out. It's a twofer.
What a valuable ward I placed earlier. The moment anyone walks into vision, Samael is ready with Universe. These two heroes together, it's like one of the best ganking duos you can get in the game. There are very few exceptions that are even better, like maybe some IO combinations can be just as fearsome, but the initiation range and the burst damage between these two, there's no time to react for CDEC. They just get run over.
But they need to find something, man, because right now EG are knocking on the CDEC door. And they really want to knock it down. The tier 3 tower stands between them, and Samael jumping in. He's going up the wyvern, the orc goes on Samael as well. They have to force off him away, and they've bought enough time for the jump out. Remember that Aegis the Immortal is still there, and it will remain there for another minute and a half. But they're going to back it up. There's farm to be had on the top lane. And still, it's a minute and a half worth of reset time. And remember that tier 2 tower is still an objective for EG to take while they continue to farm up everywhere outside CDEC space.
They put another good ward in mid, by the way, about 2 minutes ago. So they once again see the rotations from CDC coming in. Just look at how much coverage EG have on the map right now. All these observers they've placed, one will now get counter warded by Q. And I was about to say, they're going to need a gem so that they can get a little bit of a grip back on the map. He has got one on the Wyvern. Looking to find whatever EG may have placed.
And PPD buys his own. He'll start looking. I wonder if he's going to find this one observer ward. If he runs to the north right now, he is going to find it.
He's going to ping out Q here. Now they know that he has the gem. This is the highest priority gank they can get. I think it's actually better to gank Q than the Phantom Lancer if they have the choice. Mm-hmm. If they take that gem away, they could control the map. And this lineup of EG just feasts on lack of intel for the enemy team.
Xe is so scared right now. The Clockwork Rocket hit him, and he's waiting for Samael to jump in. Hilariously enough, though, Samael doesn't have the mana to make such a long jump. He had a DD rune bottled up. But his Ted Bluntstone charges is just not enough to give him that huge amount of regeneration. But now with 4,000 gold sitting in Samael's bank account, he can buy whatever he wants again.
I think we may see him go for a Shiva's Guard this game. Just even more burst when they're ahead like this, and increasing his mana pool by a lot, and his tankiness, of course, against the PL, who will be dealing mainly physical damage, but on the other hand, you could say he should just play the dodging game and try not to get caught at all, and just itemize full aggression with perhaps even a Hex as his next item. I think we'll have it answered soon enough. There is the BKB on Queen of Pain. It was either this or a Hex for her, and this is a pretty defensive approach that will probably guarantee she at least gets her spells off in the fight, but it doesn't really put CDC in a position where they can pressure. I guess no item would have allowed them
Universe.
To win the deficit there.
Smoke's gonna break. Does he go for a blind hook shot? It's too late. Both TPs have gone out from CDEC. The rocket will reveal no one is left there.
But they get map control again. Even if this doesn't work out for them, they'll now take over the Radiant Jungle. No wards on PPD though. I think they've used all the wards they had when they had those four down a moment ago. But still, this is an area that cannot be farmed by CDC. Fear is slowly but steadily becoming a monster.
Too late. He's able to blink himself away. Samael really wanted to find that kill, and yep, you're 100% right. It's going to be the Shiva's Guard Storm. A real issue considering you're able to use your items while you're inside the Ball Lightning. So not only are you going to get the Ball Lightning damage, but you're also going to have the Shiva's effect all over CDEC. And they're already having a hard enough time trying to fight when they're underneath the cooldown, let alone even trying to kill Fear. Like, this guy's got... He's already got his butterfly, he's got regeneration, he's got immunity, and the SMY. It's everything a good gyro needs.
Yeah, this might be the game-winning push. If EG take a good fight here, how many buybacks do CDC even have? They have none.
Nothing up.
That's
nothing
a problem.
And in they come. The hook shot. They catch out the Spirit Breaker. The cooldown's in the perfect position. Fear turning on the flat cannon. So much build damage to Mal once more. And he's going to find Mal. There goes your Winter Wyvern. Your PL heavily injured. All they can do is just sit back at well and heal up while they lose. They lose their buildings on the bottom lane. The tier 3 tower's gone. The melee racks will join it. And what can CDEC even do to stop this? With no other tier 2 towers out in the map, EG can just move from one lane to another inside the base, and Samael doesn't want to even stop. He jumps forward, looking for a reaction out of CDEC. Can't get one, though, as the illusions will push EG back out of the base.
Yeah, showing some respect to their opponents here, not forcing even further in. I think they might have been able to win the game there, but they're playing it safe. They want to get the BKB back on Fear. They want to get full mana on Samael. Now, if they would have noticed that Queen of Pain used Sonic Wave in that fight, it might give them a little more confidence, but there's just no point in risking it in such a big match as this. It's not like they're losing anything by just waiting another 30 seconds and there's no like ages expiring. Mm-hmm. They have to have a feeling there's no big key items coming up for CDC anytime soon.
In fact, EG can just wait for the next Aegis of the Immortal or use Roshan as bait. Because CDEC have to contest this. If they actually go up against EG with Aegis as the Immortal, you can just give it a Storm Spirit. Samael will go in. He'll probably murder two. come back to life again, murder another two, and the game is done. That's the position CDEC is in right now, with actually over a 20k net worth advantage going the way of Evil Geniuses. It's the same on the experience as well. CDEC have had so much control in all of their games, through like group stage, as well as here in the main event. They've crushed EG before, and well, LGD didn't stand much of a chance either, and now you just look at it, and EG, they are so far ahead of CDEC, and CDEC need to find something. They get the magical DD rune on bot lane. Dire of no vision, so they can take this, and they're actually waiting under the cover of smoke. It's a very tempting thing to actually go for this. They're gonna charge in. Some mail being pushed back and awkward up. They're gonna turn around, but now Universe hooks on in some mail. Almost dead, he is dead. Where's your buyback? Here she comes, the TP, the T1 towers. Two heroes down already. This could be it. The money will let EG win this fight. They kind of want it anyway with the amount of damage the Fear has. Storm jumping all the way back up again. They find aggressive. Queen of Pain the only one up. It fell at the last hope, and it was. EG will take game one in the TI5 Grand Final from what looked like an unstoppable CDEC.
They just got counterplayed really hard in this game. Usually their smoke ganks work out in the early game and they find the key kills they use to snowball the game, but in this case, EG read the map very well. They take a lot of initiative themselves with the storm as well as the clockwork. Very well executed game by them.
Terrific Dota from Evil Geniuses. CDEC will have a moment to think about what has just happened here. And of course, while we have that moment, we'll throw it back to the panel.
Yes.